A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis for 10th of April 2021, brought to you by the Shankar IAS Academy. Here is the list of news articles that will be taken up for today's discussion, and the video is time-stamped for your convenience. Our first topic today is apology topic based on this news article. This news article mentions that a Kerala minister has been found guilty by the Kerala Lokayukta. He has been found guilty of abuse of power, favoritism, nepotism, and violation of oath of office. So we'll have to know about favoritism, nepotism in the ethics context, and the rest we'll have to deal with in the polity aspect. Here, abuse of power means the misuse of a position of power or authority to take unjust advantage of individuals, organizations, or governments. This includes bullying or harassing behavior, etc. So, favoritism is the practice of giving unfair preferential treatment to one person or group at the expense of another. And a very related concept is nepotism. Nepotism is when a person with power or influence practices the act of favoring friends and relatives, especially by giving them jobs. So, that's the difference between favoritism and nepotism. So, these are forms of corruption. See, simply, corruption is nothing but abuse of interested power for individual or private gain. So, the minister has been found guilty of these charges by Kerala Lokayukta. In this regard, let us see what is Lokpal and Lokayukta and their roles. Here is the syllabus for your reference. See, literally, Lokpal means caretaker of people. By this, it refers to an anti-corruption authority or ombudsman who represents the public interest. So, know that the concept of an ombudsman is Swedish. Ombudsman is a democratic institution and refers to an officer appointed by the legislature to handle complaints against administrative and judicial actions, mainly from the corruption perspective. And this ombudsman in India is called Lokpal in the national level and Lokayukta at the state level. These institutions and authorities were recommended to be set up by the first Administrative Reforms Commission for the redressal of citizens' grievances regarding corruption. This recommendations was accepted by Government of India, and after so many years, a legislation was brought in this regard, which is the Lokpal and Lokayukta Act of 2013. The Act seeks to provide a uniform vigilance and anti-corruption roadmap for the nation, both at the center and the state level. So, the Act established Lokpal as the ombudsman at the center and Lokayukta as the ombudsman in the states. So, let us discuss about the Lokpal of India. So, as we saw, it was established in 2013 and the Act defines it as follows. An Act to provide for the establishment of a body of Lokpal for the Union and Lokayukta for the states to inquire into allegations of corruption against certain public functionaries and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. So, as you can see, it says certain public functionaries, not all the public functionaries. So, we have exceptions in its application. See, the Lokpal of India is the first institution of its kind in independent India, and it was established to inquire and investigate into allegations of corruption against public functionaries who fall within the scope and ambit of this Act. It provides a mechanism for prompt and fair investigation and prosecution in cases of alleged corruption. So, why is this body so important? So, it is important at two levels. Firstly, because India is a signatory to 2003 United Nations Convention Against Corruption. So, the institution reflects the commitment of the Indian government to provide clean and responsive governance along with containing and punishing the acts of corruption. Secondly, the corruption malpractices gives rise to citizens' grievances against the administration. And one of the keys to the success of a democracy is redressing such grievances. So, this act strengthens our country's democracy. Next, let us see the jurisdiction of Lokpal. That is, who are the public functionaries that are covered under the act? Lokpal has jurisdiction to inquire into allegation of corruption against anyone who is or who has been Prime Minister or a Minister in the Union Government or a Member of Parliament. And apart from that, it also has jurisdiction over those who are or had been officials of Union Government under Group A, Group B, Group C and Group D. So, it applies on those not only in the service but also who were in the service. So it also covers the chairpersons, members, officers and directors of any board, corporation, society, trust or autonomous body that is either established by an act of a parliament, say the Societies Act can be an example here, or that is wholly or partly funded by the union or the state government. It also covers any society or trust or body that receives foreign contribution above 10 lakh, even though it is private. Simply, Lokpal has jurisdiction over all the members of parliament and central government employees in case of corruption and over some other private entities also. So you can imagine the power vested on the body. So coming to its composition, Lokpal consists of a chairperson and 8 other members. And they all are appointed by the President of India and they hold office for a term of about 5 years or until they attain the age of 70, whichever is earlier. The chairperson should be a former or an incumbent Chief Justice of India or judge of a Supreme Court. And among members, 4 are judicial members who are former or incumbent judges of Supreme Court or Chief Justices of High Court. Now let us see some of the important powers and function. It is vested with the power of search and seizure and also vested with powers under the Civil Procedure Code for the purpose of conducting preliminary inquiry and investigation. It has the power of attachment of assets and taking other steps for eradication of corruption. And apart from that, it also has power of superintendence and direction over any central investigation agency, including the CBI, for the cases referred to them by the Lokpal. Next, about Lokayukta. So it is established under Section 63 of the Lokpal Act. It is established in every state mandatorily to deal with complaints relating to corruption against certain public functionaries as covered by the state legislature enacted for this purpose. So it is mandatorily provided for by the law. For example, the Kerala Lokayukta is established under Kerala Lokayukta Act of 1999. So as you can see, it is a state level body. Generally speaking, the governor appoints the Lokayukta in the states and the composition, function, etc. are determined by the state statute in force for the purpose. So that brings us to the end of the discussion on Lokpal and Lokayukta. Look at this. This news is regarding the direct tax collection. See, the direct tax is a tax that a person or organization pays directly to the entity that imposed it. So, the direct tax cannot be passed on to a different person or entity, which is the case with indirect taxes. The individual or organization upon which the tax is levied is responsible for paying it. India levies various types of direct taxes. Some of them are corporate tax, income tax, capital gains tax, etc. As you can see, corporate tax and income tax forms a major chunk of India's direct tax revenues. See, when we talk about direct taxes, the most important point to be noted is the progressive nature of it. What is a progressive tax? A progressive tax is a tax in which the tax rate increases as the taxable amount increases. For example, consider income tax. More the income, higher is the percentage of taxation. Such structure imposes a lower tax rate on low-income earners than those with high-income earners. So what happens here is wealth redistribution. Now coming back to the article, according to the news, India's net direct tax collection for the year 2020-2021 grew by almost 5% year on year. So what is net? See, net direct tax collection is the gross collection excluding the income tax refunds. India's net direct tax collection for the year 2020-2021 comes around 9.45 lakh crore. But the surprising fact is that this number has exceeded our estimate. See, the estimate was to collect only 9.05 lakh crore due to the pandemic effect, but we surpassed this amount quite comfortably. Such high collection reflects the gradual economic recovery in the recent months. It might also indicate the formalization of the economy. In addition to that, tax experts also say that the schemes like Vivad Se Vishwas helped in the increasing the collection. So what is the scheme? The Vivad Se Vishwas scheme was introduced by our government to settle the huge number of pending direct tax cases. See, the worrying information is that we have a lot of litigations and disputes regarding the direct tax collections. Before the introduction of the scheme, we had almost 9.32 lakh crore worth of revenue blocked in approximately 4.8 lakh appeals pending at various income tax appellate forums. So, this scheme provides an opportunity to settle these pending appeals and disputes in a quick fashion. These entities who opt for the scheme have to pay a requisite tax, following which all litigation against them is closed by the tax department and the penal proceedings being dropped. So, this scheme has two benefits. It not only solves the disputes quickly, but also increases our revenue too. So, this brings us to the end of discussion on direct taxes. Now look at this news article about Ken Betwa River Interlinking Project. So in this slide, let's see about Ken Betwa River Interlinking Project. As we know, the rainfall pattern in India is highly distorted, with most of the rainfall happening in about 100 days in a year. Thank you to monsoon. Also, due to geographical variations, India has got some of the driest and the wettest places in the world. So, keeping this in view, the National Perspective Plan was prepared by the then Ministry of Irrigation to transfer water from water surplus basin to water deficit basin. And the Ken Betwa River Linking Project is the first project of the National Perspective Plan for interlinking of rivers. This project involves the transfer of water from Ken River in Madhya Pradesh to Betwa River in the UP. And it is done through the construction of Daudan Dam and a canal interlinking these two rivers. The project is expected to provide an annual irrigation of 10.62 lakh hectares and drinking water supply to about 62 lakh people, and also to generate 103 megawatt of hydropower. Remember, this project will be of immense benefit to the water-starved region of Bundelkhand that is spread across the districts of Panna, Chhatarpur, Damoh, Dartia, Vidisha, Shivpuri, Raisen of Madhya Pradesh, and also Mahoba, Jhansi, Lalitpur of UP. The project is expected to pave the way for more interlinking of river projects to ensure that scarcity of water does not become an inhibitor for the development of the country. So, on looking at its positive side, drought reduction, improvement in irrigation, increase in water and food supply, and also electricity production are some of the benefits associated with such move. But the project is said to have a potential damage of around 40% of the Panna Tiger Reserve in Madhya Pradesh, which is considered to be an outstanding example of translocation and successful breeding of tigers. Quickly about Panna Tiger Reserve, it is situated in the Vindhyan mountain range in the northern part of Madhya Pradesh, and Panna Tiger Reserve is spread over Panna and Chhatarpur districts. This reserve contains the last remaining tiger habitat of northern Madhya Pradesh. So flowing from the south to north through the reserve is the river Ken. These forests along with the Ken Gharial Sanctuary form a significant part of this reserve. Students note that it is the least polluted of Yamuna's tributaries. And another interesting fact is that the reserve is also dotted with 2000-year-old rock paintings. Have a look at this editorial article. This editorial article talks about the India-Russia bilateral relations. Recently, Russian Foreign Minister Sergey Lavrov had visited Delhi, and this visit was to discuss the aspects of bilateral ties and to review preparations for the pending India-Russia annual summit later this year. So in this context, first let us have a 360-degree analysis of India-Russia bilateral relations, and then we'll see the opinion of the author. So here is the syllabus for your reference. See, Russia has been a long-standing and time-tested partner for India. Both the sides had signed the declaration on India-Russia strategic partnership in 2000, and since then Russia has been a strategic partner for India. And since then, India-Russia ties have acquired qualitatively new character. We could see enhanced level of cooperation in almost all areas of bilateral relationship. And these include political, security, defense, trade, economy, science and technology, culture and whatnot. And during the visit of the Russian president to India in 2010, the strategic partnership was further elevated to the level of special and privileged strategic partnership. So first, let us see the political relation. See, the annual summit meeting between the Prime Minister of India and the President of the Russian Federation is the highest institutionalized dialogue mechanism in the strategic partnership between India and Russia. Recently, many MOUs in the field of trade and investment, defense cooperation, transport, oil, civil nuclear cooperation, space were signed. Then there are two intergovernmental commissions. One is on trade, economic, scientific, technology and cultural cooperation, which is abbreviated as IRIGCTEC, and another on military technical cooperation. Both meet annually. Now, let us see some of the important international or multilateral organizations and connectivity projects in which India and Russia are partnering. The first one is BRICS. It is the most important one also. BRICS consists of five major emerging economies, with Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. In 2006, the BRICS countries started their dialogue, and since 2009, the meetings take place at annual meetings of state and government. The most prominent areas of cooperation are economy and finance, health, science and technology, security and business. The second one is Shanghai Cooperation Organization. This is also a very important organization, and we saw about this a few days ago also. So it's a permanent intergovernmental international organization whose creation was announced in 2001 in Shanghai, China. Note that India or Pakistan, both are not founding members. Both found their membership in the organization only in 2017. And it mainly focuses on regional security issues and fight against regional terrorism, ethnic separatism and religious extremism. So it's more concerned with the security of the region. Now, thirdly, Russia has reiterated its unwavering support to India for permanent membership in an expanded United Nations Security Council. We know that India is seeking its space in the United Nations Security Council. And finally, know that Russia has been a long-standing supporter of India's membership of Nuclear Suppliers Group. What is Nuclear Suppliers Group quickly? See, NSG is a group of nuclear supplier countries. It seeks to prevent nuclear proliferation by controlling the export of materials, equipments and technology that can be used to manufacture nuclear weapons. And note that India was not able to be a member of this allied group due to its opposition from some countries like China. And this is because India has not signed the NPT, that is Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. And it is in this regard Russia is supporting India for its membership in NSG. So these are some of the multilateral arrangements in which India and Russia are like-minded. Now, talking about defense and security cooperation, India has long-standing and wide-ranging cooperation with Russia in this field. And Russia-India military technical cooperation has evolved from a buyer-seller framework to one involving joint research, development and production of advanced defense technologies and systems. So you may remember about BrahMos missile system, as well as the licensed production of India of Su-30 aircraft and T-90 tanks are some of the examples of such flagship cooperations. And the two sides also concluded agreements on supply of S-400 air defense systems and also for manufacturing Ka-226T helicopters in India. So you can see the transition from a buyer-seller framework to joint manufacturing, right? So it is to be noted that the India and Russia also hold exchanges and training exercises between their armed forces annually. So in this regard, India-Russia INDRA exercises between the Army, Navy and Air Forces of the two countries have been held since 2005 periodically and with regularity. Moreover, joint tri-service exercises INDRA are also being held once in 2 years since 2017. The last INDRA tri-service exercise was held in India in December 2019. Now, talking on trade and economic relations, India and Russia have revised their target to increase the investments, bilateral investments, to $50 billion and the bilateral trade to $30 billion by 2025. And the top import items in India from Russia include fuel and oil, bituminous substances, then natural and cultured pearls and precious and semi-precious stones, precious metals, nuclear reactors, etc. And top exports include nuclear reactors, boilers, electrical machineries, organic chemicals, vehicles other than railway or tram, rolling stock, etc. It is also to be noted that the bilateral trade in services has remained stable during the last 5 years, with trade balance in Russia's favor, which needs to be improved in India's favor. and a few important steps and projects that could provide a major boost to bilateral trade include the operationalization of Green Corridor Project, then the International North-South Transport Corridor Project, and the signing of Free Trade Agreement with Eurasian Economic Union. And in the recent visit of the Russian foreign minister, talks on free trade agreement with the Eurasian Economic Union and the commitment for more investments in the connectivity, including the INSTC, that is International North-South Transport Corridor, and the Chennai-Vladivostok Eastern Maritime Corridor were held. Now coming to the most important area, nuclear energy. Russia is an important partner for India in the area of peaceful use of nuclear energy. The Kudankulam nuclear power plant is being built in India with Russian cooperation, and the Kudankulam nuclear power plant units 1 and 2 have already become operational, and we know that. In space cooperation, both the sides cooperate in the peaceful uses of outer space, including satellite launches, GLONASS navigation system that belongs to Russia, and remote sensing and other societal applications of outer space are being shared between India and Russia. An MOU was signed by ISRO and Roscosmos, that is Russian Space Agency, on joint activities in the field of human space flight program. And we know about Gaganyaan here. Since then, negotiation of contracts and cooperation for realization of India's human space flight program are taking place, and the Indian astronauts will be trained in the Russian facility. Now let us see what the author has to say. The author notes that the recent meeting reaffirmed traditional India-Russia ties, but there are some glitches, and the author talks in length about it. So we'll go over it one by one. Firstly, Russian foreign minister's praise of Russia-China ties in his visit to India is something to be concerned of. We know that China's aggressive behavior towards India as well as in Asia-Pacific region has always created problems. And at this point of time, if Russia goes to strengthen its relations with China, then it is going to be against the Indian interests. Secondly, while India's external affairs minister repeatedly referred India's interest as Indo-Pacific strategy, but Russia preferred to stick to his reference as Asia-Pacific strategy. So we know that the expansive mention also includes China. And according to the author, this shows the areas of divergence over the worldview. Thirdly, Russia criticized the Quad grouping as an Asian NATO. In that regard, it opined that any military alliance in Asia were inadvisable and counterproductive. And fourth is about the Russian support for bringing the Taliban into the power sharing agreement in Afghanistan. This seemed to come up against India's interest as well, since India consistently pushed for democratic Afghanistan and never encouraged Taliban in the negotiation table. Fifth concern for India is regarding Russia's deepening ties with Pakistan. So in this regard, Russia has recently announced its plan to supply military equipment to Pakistan, and this goes against India's mission to completely isolate Pakistan. So that brings us to the end of the discussion on India-Russia relations, and we saw about the bilateral relation between India and Russia. We also saw some of the areas of concern in the India-Russia ties. So consider this news article. This news article provides data about the West Bengal election candidates who face criminal charges. That is, in other words, data on criminalization of politics in West Bengal. The data is based on the analysis of Association for Democratic Reforms. Simply know that criminalization of politics refers to the fact that a person or individual with criminal antecedents or criminal records are contesting in an election, and they win the election, and they also end up becoming legislators and ministers of various departments and ministries. That is, there is an increase in the participation of people with criminal records in a democratic process, that is election. Now have a look at this graph. All that said, the information regarding criminalization of politics is not available publicly. That is, people are still ignorant about the history of the contesting candidate. So the Supreme Court has given various directions in various judgments to bridge the gap in the information regarding criminalization of politics. So in that regard, two judgments gain immense importance. So the first one is a 2018 judgment in the case Public Interest Foundation and Others versus Union of India. These directions are given here for your reference. The directions mandate that each contesting candidate should fill up the form given by ECI, and the criminal cases against that particular candidate has to be mentioned in bold letters. Further, such candidates should also inform the criminal cases pending to the political party under which the candidate is contesting. When such information is provided, it is the duty of the political party to put up the information on its website. Plus, it also has to issue a declaration regarding this in the widely circulated newspapers in the locality. So this should be given wide publicity in the electronic media also. Here, wide publicity means that the same circulation of information shall be done at least thrice after filing the nomination papers. But it was found that no such information regarding criminalization of politics was provided by the political parties in the ongoing election process. So in its judgment, the Supreme Court in its judgment, in a separate case in February 2020, the Supreme Court gave another set of directions in this regard. The case is Ram Babu Singh Thakur versus Sunil Arora and others. So these are the directions for your reference. And according to these directions, the political parties have to mandatorily upload it in the website, the detailed information regarding the candidates with pending criminal cases. This information should be uploaded along with the reasons for selection of such candidate, that is, why a person with criminal background has been selected as a candidate by the political party. Additionally, it should also mention why other individuals without criminal antecedents were left out. Such information should be published in one local vernacular newspaper, one national newspaper. Then it should also be published on an official social media platform of the political party, including Facebook, Twitter pages. And more importantly, these details shall be published within 48 hours of the selection of the candidate, or it shall be published not less than 2 weeks before the first date of filing the nominations. So as you can see, both these judgments reinforce the right to make informed choices to the citizenry as provided under Article 19 of the Constitution. And this also enhances the transparency in the democratic process. And complying to these directions, the candidates contesting in West Bengal has given information based on which ADR has did an analysis, and it was found that 25% of candidates for the fifth phase of the West Bengal Assembly election had declared criminal cases against them. That brings us to the end of discussion on criminalization of politics based on this news article. See, now look at this news article. See, recently eminent agricultural scientist M.S. Swaminathan was felicitated for his contribution towards eradicating tuberculosis, TB. This article is regarding that, and the felicitation was done by REACH, a Chennai-based non-profit organization. And REACH has been working towards eradicating TB for over 2 decades. Now, let us see this article as an opportunity to learn about M.S. Swaminathan's contribution and tuberculosis. First, let us see about M.S. Swaminathan. Mankombu Sambasivan Swaminathan is an eminent geneticist and agricultural scientist who was born on 7th of August 1925 at Kumbakonam. As we all know, M.S. Swaminathan played a prominent role in transforming the Indian agriculture through Green Revolution. So what is Green Revolution? So Green Revolution refers to a series of steps and technology transfers to the agricultural sector that caused a great surge in farm productivity. The Green Revolution was done through various steps, and they were developing high-yield varieties of grains using fertilizers and pesticides, and developing pest-resistant crops using hybrid seeds with enhanced genetics, and so on. And M.S. Swaminathan was the pioneer in bringing this movement to India. This revolutionary movement resulted in tremendous increase in food productivity and greatly reduced the occurrence of famines and our country's dependence on the other countries for food grains. Before the Green Revolution, India was highly dependent on foreign imports of food grains for food sufficiency. Now, with Green Revolution, the trend has reversed and India has become a successful food grain sufficient economy, and we are also exporting food grains to other countries. This was possible only due to the vision of this great scientist. In addition to the above laurel, M.S. Swaminathan also chaired the National Commission on Farmers 2004. See, this Commission on Farmers is an Indian commission constituted on 18th of November 2004 to address nationwide calamity of farmer suicides in India. This commission submitted a total of 5 reports, and all these reports reiterated the goal of faster and more inclusive growth. So, based on these recommendations and findings, a national draft policy for farmers was prepared and placed before the parliament in October 2007. His recommendations are considered visionary and revolutionary and is yet to be implemented in our nation. Now, let us see about tuberculosis. See, tuberculosis or TB is caused by a bacteria called Mycobacterium tuberculosis. TB is a disease that spreads from person to person through air and most often affects the lungs. And it also affects the other parts of body. Tuberculosis is curable and preventable. They are cured by prescription of anti-TB medicines. These medicines are the first-line drugs, and the most common first-line medications that are used are isoniazid, rifampicin, ethambutol, and pyrazinamide. But it is to be noted that some of the bacterial strains become resistant to first or the other line of medicines. This resistance to drugs emerges when anti-TB medicines are used inappropriately. This is a kind of antibacterial resistance that we saw a few days ago along with diphtheria discussion. So this has given rise to two types of drug-resistant TBs. The first one is the multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis, which is commonly called as MDR-TB. It is a form of TB that is caused by bacteria, which does not respond to the first-line drugs that we saw above. In order to treat the MDR-TB, second-line drugs are used. They include levofloxacin, moxifloxacin, bedaquiline, delaminid, and linezolid. The problems with the second-line drugs is that they are much more expensive than the first-line drugs, and they have a lot of side effects also. However, in some cases, more severe drug resistance can develop. This is the second type of drug-resistant TB, which is commonly called as extensively drug-resistant TB or XDR-TB. It is a more serious form of MDR-TB, and it is caused by the bacteria that does not respond to the second line of anti-TB drugs that we just saw. So XDR-TB patients can be cured, but with current drugs available, the likelihood of success is much meager than in patients with ordinary TB or even MDR-TB. So if you see the reason for development of drug resistance in India, the treatment period is very long. That is, the patient has to be put on drugs for long and regular period. When a patient fails to take the drug, the resistance develops. Besides this, poverty, population density compounds this problem in our country. So India has been struggling to combat TB. And India accounts for about a quarter of global TB burden. And India has a target to eliminate TB by 2025. So in that line, the National Strategic Plan of 2017-2025 for that period has been launched by our country. And besides that, nutritional support to those patients are provided through Nikshay Poshan Yojana. It is a direct benefit transfer scheme and it is also up and running. And apart from that, a lot of private players like Tata have been lending an active hand in combating this disease. That brings us to the end of discussion on MS Swaminathan and TB. So here we are at the last article for discussion today. Look at these news articles. Now this news article talks about India's protest against a recent freedom of navigation operation, commonly called as FONOP, conducted by US in the Indian Exclusive Economic Zone of the Western Indian Ocean near Lakshadweep. Here, freedom of navigation simply means freedom of movement of ships. It is a principle of customary international law that ships flying the flag of any sovereign state shall not suffer interference from other states apart from the exceptions provided for in the international law. And talking about FONOPs, know that they are one of the principal tools by which the United States challenges maritime claims deemed excessive under the international law. The US Navy has conducted FONOPs all over the world for nearly 40 years, but the recent operations in the South China Sea began garnering unprecedented publicity at a point of friction with China. And today we hear the news of FONOP conducted by an Indian Exclusive Economic Zone. And in this regard, US claimed that this FONOP upheld its rights, freedoms and lawful use of sea recognized in the international law. And in this regard, the US statement told that this exercise challenged India's excessive maritime claims in the region. But here, India responded by stating its position on the United Nations Convention on Law of Seas, commonly called as UN Clause. It stated that the convention does not authorize other states to carry out military exercises or maneuvers, in particular those involving the use of weapons or explosives in the exclusive economic zone and on the continental shelf without the consent of the coastal state. Here it is, India. India also rejected the US's claim that India's domestic maritime law was in violation of international law. So what is this UN clause? See, the UN clause defines the rights and responsibilities of nations in their use of world's oceans. It officially is a treaty which came into effect from 1994. And India had ratified the UN convention in 1995 and therefore bound by the provision of UN clause. Although US recognizes UN clause as a part of international customary law, but US has not yet ratified it. So this news also reports that this incident is a rare falling out between the two partners in the Quad grouping. And we remember that in the recent Quad meeting, both India and US had committed to upholding freedom of navigation in the Indo-Pacific. Here we are at the comments and clarification section. In our 29th March 2021 Hindu News Analysis, we discussed an article which talked about the ULPIN scheme. ULPIN is the full form of Unique Land Parcel Identification Number scheme. It is a 14-digit identification number that will be given to every plot of land in the country within a year. In the course of the discussion, we also discussed about the Digital India Land Records Modernization Program, commonly called as DILRMP. In the discussion, we said that the program was revamped from a centrally sponsored scheme to a central sector scheme with 100% funding from the Government of India. But in the question discussion, we said that it is a central sector scheme. So this created confusion among our valued subscribers and viewers. We sincerely apologize for the inconvenience caused, and we thank all the viewers who brought this to our notice. Now we should clarify the matter. See, in the mid-1980s, Government of India initiated two centrally sponsored schemes. One is strengthening of revenue administration and updation of land records. And the other is computerization of land records. When we say centrally sponsored scheme, it refers to those schemes where there is cost sharing agreement between central government and the states in some ratio, say 50-50 or 60-40 or 90-10, like that. If the entire scheme is absolutely funded by center, it is called as central sector scheme. Now note that both these schemes initiated in the mid-1980s were rationalized in 2008. That is, they were actually merged and the new scheme was called as National Land Records Modernization Program. This program also remained as a centrally sponsored scheme, that is sharing between center and the states. However, in 2016, even this 2008 scheme was revamped as Digital India Land Records Modernization Program. While revamping, the funding pattern was altered and it was changed from centrally sponsored scheme to a central sector scheme. So right now, 100% of the program funding is from central government. Therefore, this 2016 scheme called the DILRMP is a central sector scheme. All the above information has been sourced from a document titled as Best Practices in DILRMP, and this document was released by Department of Land Resources of Union Ministry of Rural Development of Government of India. The link for the websites are provided for your reference. So now we are at the practice question session. Consider this question. With reference to the Lokpal, consider the following statements. First statement, it is a statutory body constituted under the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988. Second statement, it has the power of superintendence and direction over any central investigating agencies, including CBI. And the third statement, Lokpal has jurisdiction to inquire into allegation of corruption against the Prime Ministers and the Member of Parliament. See, the statement one is incorrect. So we know that it is a statutory body, but it was constituted under Lokpal and Lokayukta Act of 2013 and not under this act. And we saw in the discussion statement 2 and 3 are correct. So the correct option will be option B. Consider the following statement regarding progressive taxation. First statement, progressive taxation method has increasing rate of tax for decreasing value on which the tax is being imposed. The second statement, the idea of progressive taxation is less tax on people who earn less and higher tax on the people who earn more. So the first statement is wrong because it is quite the opposite. The progressive taxation method has increasing rate of tax for increasing value on which the tax is being imposed. And the second statement is correct. We saw that during discussion. So the answer will be B, 2 only. Consider the following statement about the Ken-Betwa River Interlinking Project. The first statement, it is the first project of the National Perspective Plan for interlinking of rivers. And the second statement, it benefits the water-starved region of Bundelkhand that is spread across the districts of UP and MP. So this is a direct factual question. We saw that during discussion. So the correct option is option C, both 1 and 2. So consider this question, the drug bedaquiline is used to treat which of the following diseases? So as discussed in the article, levofloxacin, moxifloxacin, bedaquiline, delaminid, linezolid are all second line drugs used to treat tuberculosis. Hence the answer is option D, tuberculosis. So coming to the next question, according to the directions given by the Supreme Court, it is mandatory for political parties to upload and publish detailed information regarding the selected contesting candidates with pending criminal cases. Such information should be uploaded and published in which of the following? So this is again a factual question. Go through the options. First is political party's official website, political party's official social media platform, one local vernacular paper, one national newspaper. So we saw this during discussion. The correct option is option D, all the above. Coming to the last question, consider the following statements with reference to freedom of navigation frequently seen in news. The first statement is, it is the principle of customary international law that ships flying the flag of any sovereign state shall not suffer interference from other states apart from the exceptions provided for in the international law. First statement is correct. Consider the second statement, the United Nations regularly conducts freedom of navigation operation, which is frequently called as FONOPS, to ensure freedom of navigation in international waters. The second statement is incorrect. Remember, FONOPS are not operations conducted by United Nations. They are one of the principal tools by which the United States challenges the maritime claims made by any other country. So that said, the correct option will be option A, one only. Students can answer the mains question in the comments section below. So that brings us to the end of today's discussion. If you like the video, like, share and subscribe. And we post the video of the daily analysis every evening. Good day.